University, and it is the southern part of the Mount of Olives, because Mount of Olives, it's not just one mountain as we saw on the Mount Tabor, but it is Grida, горная Грида из нескольких стоящих. It's a range of small hills eastwards from Jerusalem. So the Mount of Olives consists of three hills. And now there are three towers on the Mount of Olives. The largest and the most beautiful, of course, is the bell tower of the Ascension Russian Monastery. Another one is the tower of the German church built in the beginning of the 20th century, Augusta Victoria, it's named. So it's a German Lutheran campus. And the third tower is the tower of the Hebrew University. That very hill that is where the university is situated is named Mount Scopus. It is a Latin word. In Hebrew it is Aratzufim. In English it will be a hill of the watch guards. Why it was named like this? Because during the siege of Jerusalem by the Romans in year 17, by Titus and Vespasianus, Roman generals and emperors, the center of the general's presence, Stavka,
Headquarters,
yes. The Roman headquarters were on that very hill, because from that hill there is a good view over all Jerusalem. Nearly in the same way the headquarters of the British governor during the British mandate was in Augusta Victoria. It was taken from the Germans after the First World War, and it is a good place from which you can see a lot of things. So there is a tradition that the headquarters of the governors, of the military commanders, are there. So that place is not far from this spot where your hotel is situated. So it was also named Mount Scopus. So name of that part of the Mount of Olives. And I think that this hotel, as a lot of things in this district, were built during the Jordanian rule over the East Jerusalem. Because after the independence war of Israel in 1948, Jerusalem was separated into two parts, into two cities, as Berlin used to be separated. The western was Israeli and the eastern was Jordanian. I think it's important to know that, as you know, there is a so-called Israeli-Palestinian conflict that was and that continues. But it's necessary to know that all Arab countries in 1948, they were against creation of the state of Palestine. So they were against Israel and they were against Palestine. So they were against separation of the Holy Land. And their idea was that it's much easier to separate the Holy Land between three Arab countries that are nearby: Jordan, Syria, and Egypt. And there is any reason here, because it's right that the Palestinians who are living in Gaza, for example, their language is much closer to Egyptian language. Those who are living on the western bank of Jordan River, their language is closer to Jordanian. So Jordanians, they are in reality Palestinians. So it's the same nation, except the Bedouins who are ruling Jordania. And the Arabs who are living on the north, they are closer to Syrians. That's why Arab countries that are nearby, they didn't know what's the reason to create one or even two states here, when it's so pleasant just to take parts of this land. That's why Jordanians, they occupied the eastern Jerusalem, and it was one state, till 1967, till the Six Days War, when Jerusalem was unified. But in reality, till our days we can say that it is It is not separated by the wall into, between two states. But there are two parts of Jerusalem, western, that is Jewish, and eastern, that is Arab speaking. The Hebrew University, it was situated on Mount Scopus, that geographically is eastern Jerusalem, but it was found there much before the creation of the State of Israel. So during British mandate in 1925, when there were no borders at all, the university was found on the land that were bought by different Jewish organizations, because the Jews, before 1948, they settled on the lands that were bought by Jewish organizations. They were not able just to come and to take Arab land or something like this. They were buying. That's why from, if we are speaking about contemporary events, so-called settlements in Judea and Samaria, most of them, with some exceptions, but most of them are built really on the territories that are in Israeli military control, but on the places that were bought by Jewish organizations 100 years ago. So it's complicated. So the Hebrew University was also built on the territory bought by different Jewish organizations for creation of the university. In Russian language, Russian pilgrims often say that it is a Jewish university, but it is not Jewish, but Hebrew. What is the difference? The difference is that Jewish is an ethnic or religious name, but Hebrew means the language, that it was the first academy, first university, where all academic process and teaching was in Hebrew. That was just the language that was dead for 2,000 years, because nobody spoke Hebrew after the destruction of Jerusalem and expulsion of the Jewish people. So Hebrew was a language for prayer, a language for religious literature, but it was not a spoken language. We can say that it was somehow as Latin in the Catholic Church. But when Jews started to return to the land of Israel in 19th century, they had to make a choice what language shall they will speak, because some of them spoke Yiddish, so a dialect of German language. Some of them spoke Judeo-Arabic, that is Arabic language, a dialect spoken by the Jews in the Arab countries. So they decided that if there is need to choose a common language, it must be the ancient language. And they tried. The Hebrew language, he returned to life, and it was really a kind of miracle, because it's not easy to recreate a language that was not a spoken language for centuries. There were several attempts in different European countries to recreate Irish language, to recreate Breton language, or to recreate Kafarevusa in Greek language. But it failed for different reasons, because there was no need probably. Ditches. The Mount of Zion, it has, on one side, it has Kedron Valley, and on the other ditches, on the other side, Gehenna. And here, the pagan Semitic tribes who were living here before David, before the Jews, they had their pagan rituals, especially in this place, in Gehenna. And also they had their sacrifices and human sacrifices here. That's why for the Jews who were monotheists, this place was really very dreadful. So in this place was created
Amulka. That's called Smalka. Dump, city dump.
So here was created a city dump. after Jerusalem became a capital of the ancient Israel, and the fire that was in the city dump became an image. Now we are on the way, on the big road that leads us from Jerusalem to Judea, to Hebron and to Bethlehem. And first we'll start from Judean desert, because Jerusalem, it's too cold now. That's why we need a bit of sun, some more sun. That's why we'll go to the desert now, and we'll see the Mar Sabas monastery, the monastery of Saint Sabas. That was the main monastery, the largest and the most interesting monastery in Byzantine Palestine. It was found here in 6th century during the rule of Emperor Justinian. And this is the most important monastery of the Jerusalem Patriarchate till our days. Now we're going to turn left and to leave Jerusalem. Here will be soon the last district, modern district of Jerusalem. And it's really takes probably 2 kilometers from this last district of Jerusalem, Har Chuma, to reach Bethlehem. Because in the guidebooks of the beginning of the 20th century, it was mentioned that from Jerusalem to Bethlehem is about 19 kilometers. In the guidebooks of the middle of the 20th century, it was mentioned that there are about 7 kilometers between Jerusalem to Bethlehem. Now it's written mostly that there are 2 kilometers. In reality, Bethlehem already is a suburb of Jerusalem, but there is a political separation between Jerusalem and Bethlehem, because Bethlehem is a part of Palestinian Authority. That's why there is a border between the cities. If not, we might say that it is the same city. But now we have a border between them. Builder. He wanted to fortify the borders of the Byzantine Empire. That's why he was building big monastery with huge fortifications, and to help the monks during different barbarian invasions, and to make the borders of the empire more secure. That's why all these walls and towers of St. Catherine Monastery on Sinai and of Mar Sabas Monastery, they were built by the emperors. But there were a lot of monks even before that. Because, of course, every monastery in the ancient times and nowadays is built not just by a decision of a bishop, or not just by a decision of a patriarch who would like to have a monastery on this or that place. But it is built mostly by one or several holy men who decided to escape from this world. And St. Sabas, He was a Greek monk from Cappadocia, from Asia Minor. He moved to be a monk here in the Holy Land, and he was living by his Gerunda, by his turrets in Palestine.
Elder.
Yes, elder. Elder. So elder is the same what is turrets in Russian, Gerunda in Greek, or Zaken in Hebrew. Saint Sabas came to live by his elder, and after his death he moved to the desert, and he was blessed to be a hermit really far from the world, and he had no idea to return to the world, to big cities, to the bishops and so on. But nevertheless, as many holy men experienced persons in spiritual life, very soon different disciples started to gather around him. And in the beginning, Saint Sabas tried to escape the disciples. But soon God told him that his mission was not to be a hermit, but to become an organizer. To become an organizer, one of the organizers of the monastic life in Palestine. At the time of Saint Sabas, the 6th century, was already a quite different time from the time of Saint Gerasimus of Jordan. You have visited the place where he was a monk in the 1st century. So in the beginning, in the 4th century, in the 5th century, they were different elders in the desert. They were small communities, but they were no big monasteries. In time of Saint Sabas, monasticism in Judean desert was already a big, a very numerous movement. So there was a need of creation of big communities. And Saint Sabas became one of the organizers of such kind of a monastic life. So other monks started to gather around Saint Sabas in Kedron Valley, where his cell was situated, his cave. And step by step, the number of the monks grew larger and larger. And at the end of his life, there were about 3,000 monks connected with Saint Sabas. Of course, not of them were living in Kedron Valley, where the Saint Sabas Monastery is situated now. There were several other communities, but all of them were connected with that holy person. His name, he has a nickname in Byzantine tradition. In Russian, he is Sava Освященный. In Greek, in Agiasmenos.
Sanctified.
Agiasmenos in Greek or not? I think. In Greek, he is, in English, he is Saint Sabas
the
Sanctified. What does it mean? What is the meaning of this word? That he was a holy man, but there were a lot of holy men. They were not named sanctified. Father Ilya, what do you think?
I don't think anything. I'm listening to you.
There is a very good book written in English. A very simple one, but nevertheless, it's classics already. A book of a British scholar who was an Anglican priest at the same time, Chitty. The book is named Desert the City. It is a quotation of the life of Saint Sabas, that there were so many monks that the desert became a city. So the book of Chitty, Desert the City, it's really a very good guidebook to the history of Byzantine monasticism. And there you can read that in that time, the monks were never ordained priests, because monasticism, it was a lay movement. So the monks, they are not a part of clergy, they are part of lay people who decided to live such a strict life, nevertheless in communities, not alone. So in reality, there are no monks who have no community. Probably our days there are those who live in personal hermitages. But in reality, monasticism was a community movement And it's really natural, because Christian life is a community life. It can be life in a family, it can be life in a parish, it can be life in a monastic community. It was a part of one of the lay movements in the church. That's why there was not idea even that a monk who is going to leave the world can be a priest or even a deacon, because no one becomes priest for himself, not just to celebrate liturgy for his own purpose, but to celebrate liturgy and to work for the community. That's why the monks were not priests. In time of Sabbath, monastic communities were already big enough, and it was not easy for them to catch this or that priest every Sunday or every month, or to go to a nearby village where there was a church. That's why Saint Sabas was ordained priest by the Patriarch of Jerusalem. And it was such a new thing in his time that it became his nickname, Sabas the Sanctified, that one who was sanctified by priestly ordination. And of course he became a priest for his monastic community, because this community was already very big. And his monastery, during his lifetime and after his death, it became one of the most important monasteries in Byzantine Palestine. Here were a lot of saints living here, and many of them you know. For example, Saint John the Damascene.
Of Damascus.
Of Damascus, Saint John of Damascus, who was one of the greatest Byzantine theologians. And on his theology, the decisions of the Seventh Ecumenical Council are based. And he was also one of the writers of Christian hymns and melodies. And he was a monk in St. Sabas Monastery. And probably even will see his cell in the monastery where he was writing his works and where he died and was buried after. Another one, Saint Andrew of Crete, who wrote a canon.
Покаянный канон.
Supplication.
Supplication?
Yeah, canon. Well, not supplication.
It's a text.
It's a repetitive
canon that is written in the Orthodox Church on the first week of the Great Lent. Saint Andrew was a great hymnograph. And before he became a bishop of Crete, he was a simple monk in Saint Sabas Monastery. Such a service that we know nowadays and we practice sometimes even as Всенощное бдение.
All night vigil.
All night vigil. It was invented here in the monastery of St. Sabas, because all night vigil,
probably it was near the Orthodox Church, here, then the buses.
This all night vigil was first time celebrated here in St. Sabas Monastery. Why? Because the monks, not of them, were living in the monastery itself. They were living all over the Kedron Valley. And it was not easy for them to come for short services several times a day. That's why St. Sabas decided that the monks should stay in their cells and they should keep for long all-night vigils that are before liturgy on Sunday or on holiday. And it was the tradition of St. Sabas. And after it influenced all the style of the ecclesiastical celebrations in Palestine, so what we know today as the Palestinsky Typikon, so the typical
Palestinian
of Palestinian church in Palestine, of Patriarchate of Jerusalem, it was in reality the typical of St. Sabas Monastery. So this very monastery influenced all the liturgical circle of the Orthodox Church in Palestine and in all the world. And in this monastery there are a lot of very precious manuscripts and old icons and so on. So it's And when we'll go to this monastery, we'll see that it is really situated in a terrible desert, far from the civilized world. And even nowadays, we are obliged, we should change our big bus into small buses, because the big bus cannot cross the desert with wild animals and with the scorpions and with all difficulties of the desert life. So we'll move from this bus to smaller ones, as we used to do on main tower.
Rather far, we can see the Dead Sea. So we are on the middle of the road between Jerusalem to the Dead Sea. And so if we would like to walk for 3 or 4 hours more, we can reach the Dead Sea. But it's much more interesting to do it in August, when it's really hot. On the left side, there is Kedron Valley. It starts in Jerusalem between the Old City and Gethsemane, and it's going up to the Dead Sea. The name of the Dead Sea is connected with the fact that about 40% of the water is salt. So nobody is living there. There are no plants, there are no fishes. And on the left side from here, on the slope of this hill, we can see the fiery Gehenna of our days. So Gehenna in biblical times in Jerusalem, it looked like this. So it's a burning place.
It's a burning place.
On the right. On the right there is a Dead Sea. We can see a small part of the Dead Sea. And here is a very dangerous part of the road. This new road was built a couple of years ago. Before it was probably the only place where pilgrims started to pray, really. Now they don't, because they see that there are such borders here, it's not so dangerous, it's the road is good, the buses are not so old as they used to be several years ago, so there is no need to pray. But before they did, they sing, it was an important place. And here there is Gehenna, not far from this place. Explanations to all the groups, so we can use our audio devices, it will be easier. And we'll go down to the monastery
after. In Palestine, in the land of Israel. Because it is very important that the monks were Отец Илья. The monks were a part of lay community, and that they left the world, and that they used to live in the places really inaccessible from the cities. Even nowadays, it was not easy to come here. We have a new road, we have buses, probably not so new, but nevertheless. But we had to change them, and it takes time. and 100 years ago, when there was no road and no buses, really very few pilgrims could reach this place. So it was a safe place for the monks. And it was really a desert without any life. I had a question about women, because it was a community of men. There were no women who were able to live in such a desert. But when St. Savas, he built the monastery. From here we don't see the monastery. We can see only the exterior wall of the monastery. And the monastery itself is down under the slopes. So when he built the monastery, he decided to prohibit women to come in. But he had built a hotel for the women, this tower that we see on the right side. It is the tower of the women's hotel. And who was the first inhabitant of this hotel? Who was the first to live there? What do you think? It was, of course, mother of St. Sabas. And mothers of other monks.
Yeah.
And St. Sabas decided that it's quite normal that for mothers, their children are always small, even if they have left the world to live as monks, as ascets in the desert. So, of course, it's much better not to permit them to come in. That's why the entrance for women, not for young women, first of all, there were no young women, but for mothers, it was prohibited. But St. Sabas himself was not a cruel man. He wanted his mother and other mothers of the monks to be saved. That's why he have built a kind also of a monastery, a hotel for women, on the topmost place, so the mothers, they were able to see everything that was going on in the monastery, because the hill is over the monastery. So the mothers, these mothers, they could think that they continue to govern all the process of life of their children, but without possibility to enter. So it was for salvation, and for the monks, and for their mothers. So now we go to the entrance to the monastery. Normally, there is a monk who comes out and who make explanations for women, who take out some relics to venerate. They give cups of tea. So we'll go there together. Probably our Greek ladies of Greek origin will be able to translate something, because in the monastery there is one monk who is American, who is a convert to Orthodoxy, Father Lazarus. He's very nice, but normally he's inside the monastery. But after, for our ladies, of course it's necessary to climb up this ladder to come up to that women's hotel, because there is a kind of observation point, and you'll see the monastery as mother of St. Sabas could do it, and you'll see much more than we'll see from inside. How long will stay in the monastery? It depends on the monks who receive us, but normally it's about 40 minutes, like this. Probably some of our fathers would like to stay in the monastery, so, but I think that we'll leave the monastery more or less in the same number.
С правой стороны будет видно цистерны, которые будут менять быстрее. Скажи, Бог, так кто остается?
And there is no smelling, and the bodies they have
incorrupt,
and no incorrupt, because there is corruption, but there is no smelling.
Mm-hmm.
No odor. And this is of the grace. we believe of the saints and of the saints, all of the saints, because in this monastery there are announced 26 saints in 1,500 years history. History that it has not stopped. The monastery, the service here has never stopped. Never stopped. A few times there were a little, few monks, but never stopped the liturgy. Before 7 years, we celebrated the 1,500 years. This church, the Catholicon, is from St. Sabas. But it is not the first church. The first church is there, is of St. Nicholas. It is a cave, actually. We'll go after to see. And this is the grave, the tomb of St. Sabas. The first time, until 200, 300 years, the body of St. Sabas, after he buried, he died 533, and he lived about 50 years in the monastery, and totally 94. After 14 years that I'm buried, they discovered that the body is incorrupt. And all the time the body was here, but suddenly, we don't know how, the body is found in Constantinople, Istanbul. And with the Crusades, the Latins took the body and moved it to Venice, Italy. And now is in this, the saint is back in his home from 1965. And you can venerate the tomb, and after we go inside to venerate the body. Actually here 1 year. We have celebrated yes, before some days before we closed 1 year came the icon.
Blessed and Truth, they were told the sweet man.